Good morning.
Yeah, good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone here this morning, and it's really good to see us all come out and celebrate this week. And as the hour approached for Jesus and his time of suffering and his eventual death on the cross, his burial and his resurrection, he was spending time in prayer with his Father in heaven. And these are the words that he says in John chapter 17, verse 1 to 3. He says, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the one and the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." And as we know, and as we continue to celebrate this moment 2,000 years ago, we see that the Son was glorified. He did glorify the Father, and we continue to glorify him and worship him today, as he has brought the opportunity for eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that is what we worship, and that is what we celebrate today. So welcome here. I'm glad we can worship together this morning. This one note to take note of is that we won't be having an offertory in the service, but the offering is going to purchase Bibles for grads in Hague this year. So if you want to give towards that, there is a box in the foyer. So on the way out or whatever, if you remember, you can give towards that cause there. But other than that, welcome you here, and we'll worship him today. So worship our Lord.
Good morning. I want to invite you to worship with us. If you can, stand up. Let's worship our Lord.
To you.
Morning. This morning, I get to do a children's feature, so I would like if all the kids could come up if they want to. Adults, you can not. So any kids who want to come up here, and that's probably why you guys didn't sit in the front row. How many of you guys got to put on clean clothes today? Hey guys, look this way. Guys, look. Can you guys sit here? Can you guys sit on right here? Yeah, right on. Okay. Oh, there's lots of you guys. This is so good. So guys, question. How many of you guys put on clean clothes today? How many of you got a new set of clothes today? Really? Wow, right on. Clothes are important, right? You can tell a lot about people by what they wear. I'm going to pull out some clothes from this backpack here. It's not just a diaper bag. Okay, so you're going to tell me what it is about this person who wears this clothes. Okay, what can you tell me about someone who wears this clothes?
A hunter?
Right on. So this is a hunter who wants to be seen, right? Okay, so what if I wore it this way? A hunter that doesn't want to be seen. Okay, so there's this one. I have another set of clothes here. Who would wear this? What could you... Okay.
A soccer person.
Yes, a soccer player, soccer person. Right on. Okay. I got another one.
A baby.
Yeah, a baby would wear that. Yeah. Do you know what? That's right. Okay, guys. Do you know today I want to teach you a Bible verse. And so clothes are really important. Before I tell you the Bible verse, do you guys know anything about Adam and Eve? Adam and Eve were the first people that ever lived, right? Okay. So they actually sinned, right? And since they sinned, what did they do after they sinned? Do you guys remember?
They got sent out of the garden.
Right. But do you know what? They got sent out. But they were wearing clothes then, right? God made clothes for them. Do you guys remember that story? Okay. So it's the first one in your Bible, right on. So Adam and Eve got clothes from God, and this clothes was from an animal that died. Okay? So God provided clothing for Adam and Eve, but he had to kill an animal to do it. Okay? You got that? Understand? So clothing is really important. Okay. Now, Let's take a look at this verse. I'll see if I can do this. I'm reading in 1 Corinthians. Do you guys know what Good Friday is about? Like, what happened on Good Friday a long time ago?
Jesus died on the cross.
Right on. And what happened on Easter? Okay, who's gonna tell me?
He rose from the dead.
Right on, he rose from the dead. So on Good Friday he died, and on Easter he rose from the dead. So why did he do this? That's the question. We actually sang, my whole story is in what we sang this morning already. Okay, I'm gonna read in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. For our sake, he made him to be sin. Do you guys know that Jesus became sin for us? That's what this verse is saying. So, for our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin. So Jesus was perfect, and he took on our sin. It's like Jesus. Do you guys ever get dirty jacket? You get dirt on your jackets? Yeah? You guys all get dirt on your jackets? What happens to your jacket? It gets... Okay, sometimes it gets stained. So washing doesn't help, does it? Sometimes it goes through the washing machine and it still is stained. It's still dirty. Okay, so Jesus became sin for us. So that in him, I'll start again, guys. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Do you guys know? Hey, Maddie, do you know that when we sin, it's like we make our jackets dirty, but not our real jackets, but our spiritual jackets. And so God sees us and he sees the sin and he sees us wearing the sin on us. Do you understand that? So it's like kind of like wearing clothes, but God is looking at who we are. Okay? And so when Jesus died on the cross, he actually took that dirtiness, all of our sin, he took that on him. And then he died. He died in our place because the only way to make sin go away is to have blood shed. And that's what Jesus did. So when we sin, that's like, makes God so sad. And so Jesus died for us. And so the amazing thing is that Jesus lived perfectly. And so Jesus gives us his beautiful cleanness, just like putting on a clean jacket. Does that make sense, guys? That's really what Easter is about. When Jesus died and exchanged our sinfulness for his righteousness. Do you guys know what righteousness is? Righteous? This word, this Bible verse uses righteousness. Do you guys know what righteousness is? No, can I explain it? I'm going to try to explain it in a way that I understand, okay? Righteousness is when we are right before God. That means that God isn't angry, doesn't want to punish us anymore. God wants to give us hugs. God wants to love us. And so when we put our trust in what Jesus did on the cross, God shows favor to us. He loves us. He wants to love us. You guys have sat really well, mostly. I'm going to give you something that I want you to think about. When we get clean clothes, they almost glow when they come out of the washing machine, right? They don't. Yours don't. What kind of laundry detergent? No. So, guys, I want to give you this, but I just want you to remember how God sees you. When you put on this clean righteousness that God offers, God sees you and you are glowing. Okay? So you're like lights in the world. And so this will only last for maybe a day, but you know what? The righteousness, that glowing before God will last a lifetime when you put your faith in Him. Can I pray with you guys? Hold on. Can I pray with you guys? And then I'll hand these out to you. Okay, let's pray together. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for a day where we can celebrate how much you love us, how you have sent your son Jesus to die in our place. I pray that you'd help these kids to understand how incredible your love is for us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, guys, you only get one, okay? Okay, take one. They're like bracelets, okay, guys? Okay, I got more here, guys, okay? Oh, please go back to your seats, yeah.
Next song is Nothing But the Blood.
Away precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of of blood, a crown of thorns, you gave it all, sins you bore. Oh, 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 there is no greater love. Oh, the cross, what you've done, it was more than enough. More than enough for the cross, what you've done. The power of your blood was more than enough. The sacrifice that changes story, the nails in your hands, the hands that save me, the grave of the sin, death lost to sin. As the lion roared in victory, the sacrifice that changed his story, the nails in your hands, the hands that saved me, the grave was sealed, death lost to sin. As the lion roared in victory, oh, the cross.
Finished.
what you've done. The power of your blood is more than enough.
You may be seated.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. He created man and woman.
What's up?
Hey, girl!
But, as we all know, they disobeyed God and they brought sin into the world.
She did it! It was her!
It was you!
You did it! It's all your fault!
Okay, break it up, Hold your horses. Because of this sin, we became separated from God.
Get off my lawn!
Why do I have to go? She's the one that ate the fruit
my
first.
My fault! You ate the fruit too! You're such a baby!
Well, what do we do now?
Well, I guess you're out of luck. The end.
It's all your fault.
Just kidding.
What?
God is a holy God, meaning he is set apart. He is the sinless, perfect creator of all things. We lost the ability to be near him because of sin. But God, who loves us so much, still wanted to make a way to dwell among us.
That sounds tricky.
Well, it is, and it isn't. That's the problem with holiness. God is holy, and we are not. Our sin cannot coexist with holiness. So when we sin, it pushes us away from him.
So, God promised he would send a Messiah to bring us back into his holiness, but in the meantime, in order for his people to be anywhere near him, God created a system of steps that man could go through to come back into his holiness.
So, do you mean like taking off your muddy shoes before you go back inside the house?
Well, sort of. More like boxes.
Boxes?
What? Yes. A box within a box within a box.
In the Old Testament, God gave very specific instructions to his people for building his home, or tabernacle, the place where his people can go and meet with him.
On the first day of the first month, ye shall erect the tabernacle of the tent of meeting, and ye shall put in it the ark of the testimony, and you shall screen the ark with the veil.
So, God's people built...
And you shall bring in the table and arrange it. And you shall bring in the lampstand and set up its lamps.
Cool. So, God's people built the tabernacle...
And you shall put in the golden altar for incense before the ark of the testimony and set up the screen for the door of the tabernacle.
You done?
I have three more pages.
Well, I think we get the gist. We only have a few minutes. If people really want to know more, they should come to the youth farm and see the tabernacle there.
And it's the only one in Canada. God's people built the tabernacle according to God's instruction.
But how do we get to be with God?
Well, this is where the sacrifice process comes in. There were sacrifices for everything. Remember the box within the box within the box? Let me explain. First, the people of Israel would bring their sacrifice to the first box, or outer court.
The requirement for a sacrifice was an animal without blemish. Different animals were required for different kinds of sacrifices. Poor Fluffy, he didn't deserve what he got.
Not at all.
May he rest in peace. Then, there was the holy place.
This was only for the priest to enter. They acted as the representatives of all the people. Mm-hmm.
And then there was the Holy of Holies.
Do not go in there.
Why not?
Just don't do it. Trust me. There's some really scary stuff in there. Like Indiana Jones kind of scary stuff.
If you say so.
Don't say I didn't warn you.
Okay.
Anyway, the Holy of Holies was where the Ark of the Covenant was kept, and it was also where God's presence was.
So, once a year, one priest was allowed to go in and make an atonement for the people's sins.
But there's like a ton of sin.
Right, but because God is a good father, he doesn't make it hard for us to know how to obey him. So, he gave the Israelites a list of things that they could and couldn't do.
Don't steal your neighbor's cow.
There's a sacrifice for that.
Don't swear an oath you have no intention of keeping.
There's a sacrifice for that.
Don't hurt anyone breaking into your house unless it's night.
There's a... What?
That's what it says.
Are you sure?
Okay, that's probably enough. There are a lot of laws that...
That's weird. Why would it just be at night? That makes no sense.
How am I supposed to know that?
You have to remember that this was a very different time and a very different culture. We might not understand everything about the laws, but we do know that God created them so that everyone would be treated fairly and that there would be order. He loved his people so much.
And he also gave them standards to live by to illustrate his holiness.
When you have any sort of boil or sore, you should get it checked out by the priest.
Unclean!
If you have leprosy, you should also get that checked out by the priest, and then you'll be sent to a leprosy camp away from everyone else.
Unclean!
Don't eat pigs!
Unclean!
Don't eat camels!
Unclean!
Don't eat bats!
Unclean!
When you touch a dead body, you'll have to go to the unclean camp and wash it off.
Unclean!
These rules were made by God to protect his people.
It is also an everyday reminder of how holy God is and how unholy we are.
Unclean.
Right.
You, so. Unclean. This is funny.
I know, right?
The whole system of the tabernacle and the sacrifice was to keep God's people in community with him and with each other.
So, hundreds and hundreds of years later, when God did send his son Jesus as a baby,
God's promise of a savior was fulfilled.
Jesus grew up living a perfect, sinless life.
God created the law for his people, and Jesus came to fulfill the law.
Jesus was crucified on a cross. He took on all of our sins. The sins that had been committed, and the sins yet to be committed.
This perfect, sinless Lamb who knew no sin became sin for you and for me. And just before he died, he declared,
"It is finished."
No more sacrifices.
No more separation from God.
No more death.
The problem with holiness was solved.
Now, it is up to you to accept God's free gift of life and to live holy lives pleasing to him.
But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses,
made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved.
And raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
So that in the coming ages, he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus.
It is finished.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to be reading from the book of John, Gospel of John, chapter 18, verse 28 through 40. I'll just give you a minute if you have your Bibles, if you want to turn there. John 18, 28 to verse 40. I'm reading from an NIV. Then the Jews led Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanliness, the Jews did not enter the palace. They wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," the Jews objected. This happened so that the words of Jesus had spoken, indicating the kind of death he was going to die, would be fulfilled. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you king of the Jews?" "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked. "Or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "It was your people and your chief priests who handed you over to me. What is it that you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You are right in saying I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" Pilate asked. With this he went out again to the Jews and said, "I find no basis for charge against him, but it is your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "No, not him. Give us Barabbas." Now Barabbas had taken part in a rebellion. Thank you.
Good morning. It's great to look out over the crowd and see people from other churches. Some of you I recognize and some of you I don't. We have the renovations at the Hague Gym, so we weren't able to meet there. But I'm glad you came to worship with us here, and hopefully next year we'll be able to meet together. It feels like it's been a long time since we've met in the Hague Gym, but hopefully next year it'll work out. Do you wish there was a way to know if someone was telling the truth? You could know they were telling the truth. I was talking to someone who was going through the process of getting into the Saskatoon Police Force. And one of the steps in that process is taking a polygraph test, or we would call it a lie detector test. I thought the point wasn't to get into the deepest, darkest secrets, but I think that is part of it. To see what you've done, to see if you'll tell the truth regardless of the question. I was watching an interview of a retired FBI agent who, that was his job. He was the polygraph examiner, and he claimed that through his experience over the years, he was able to determine if people were lying just by looking at them and not by using a polygraph. He said, "The eyes are the window to the soul." And he would say that you could, if you question someone and they look up and to the right, they're actually trying to make something up. They're trying to visualize something so it's a lie, something that actually didn't happen. And they say if you ask someone a question, they look to the left, then they're actually trying to remember something that did happen, so it's true. But if you're left-handed, then it's flipped the other way around. Then left is a lie and right is true. He also said that the moment you ask them the question and they look right at you, they're trying to see if you're buying it, because they're lying. He said if they rub their neck or they sit there and they tap their fingers or look at their watch, it's a good indication that they're not telling the truth. Now, I don't know if any of this is accurate. My only fear of telling you this is now you're going to be trying to try this out on other people, and that could get awkward or weird. I do have, what I want to talk about today is the passage that was just read, and thank you, Dave, for reading that passage. It's a short discussion about truth. We'll see that truth can be sought, it can be found, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it'll be acted on accordingly. Even though our story today is 2,000 years old, people haven't changed. One might still disregard truth because it's inconvenient. The title of my message today is The Inconvenient Truth, and no, I'm not talking about global warming, because I know there's a documentary that's similar name. We're going to be following two characters that play a role in our redemption story. One of them is a politician who has the power to condemn people to death, and the other person is Jesus Christ, a man and the Son of God, our Redeemer. So the text we just heard, it's part of a greater story of Jesus who was sentenced to death on our behalf. Today we remember Good Friday, and I'm glad that we can come together for this. It's a sobering event. I think if we would have been in person, we would have witnessed the last few hours of Jesus' life before he died. I dare say we would have been sick to our stomach. But those events, those few hours were necessary because it was prophesied. It was part of God the Father's plan to restore the barrier that had been caused by sin between us and God. Jesus was arrested. He was taken by the religious leaders. He was charged with these trumped up charges and this kangaroo court, and they found him guilty, and they brought him to a higher court. And that's where we pick up our story. It's in John chapter 18, so I hope you have your Bible there, that you can turn with me to John chapter 18, verse 28 is where we'll start. Jesus is brought to Pilate, and the two of them meet face to face, just the two of them, the crowd isn't around, and Pilate is trying to get to the truth, and he doesn't realize that truth is staring him right in the face. Let's pray before we go any further. Our Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time where we can gather together different churches, different congregations as brothers and sisters, and that we can worship together, we can remember the sacrifice that your Son made. And Father, some of us have heard this story so many times. Lord, I pray that this will not be dull, that this will not be something that we just disregard because it's so old or so familiar. Father, I pray that we can listen to it, and maybe there's some here who have never heard this story before. Lord, I pray that we can listen with awe, with wonder, that we can listen with gratitude. And Father, I just pray that these words that I speak, they're just words unless your Holy Spirit uses them. So Father, I give them to you that you will use them this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So follow along as I read John 18. Let's read the first part of verse 28. Then the Jewish leaders took Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. So let's stop right there. So we're introduced here to Pontius Pilate. In AD 26, he was appointed as Rome's representative, as a governor, it says, to the area of Judea, which included the city of Jerusalem, which is where our story takes place. Typically, Pilate would have been in a ruling from Caesarea, which is a city on the coast, but this is during a time where the emotions are running high among the Jews. It's the Passover time. It's the time where the Jews remember when God brought them out of slavery in Egypt. And we can read about that story in the book of Exodus, but now here they are again. The Jews are under the rule of another empire. And during this time, Pilate's in Jerusalem because he needs to be on the lookout. He needs to be making sure that trouble doesn't start up so that he can command his soldiers to go and to crush any little disturbance or unrest so it doesn't boil over into a riot. Pilate is insecure. He's insecure about his position as a Roman governor, and rightly so. The Jewish people hated the Romans. They hated them for ruling over them, and so from time to time there would be revolts that would break out, and Pilate had to go and control them. And we read from secular historians that Pilate was cruel. He was oppressive. He had even redirected money from the temple treasury somewhere else, and he was morally weak, as we'll find out in our story. So needless to say, there was a lot of conflict between the Jews and Pilate. They hated him, and the feeling was mutual. History tells us that he hated Judea. He hated the Jewish religion. But the Jewish leaders were about to make a request that had to go through Pilate. So let's keep reading verse 28, the last half. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanliness, they did not enter the palace because they wanted to be able to eat the Passover. Since Pilate was the governor, that also made him judge. The Jewish leaders brought to Pilate, they brought Jesus to Pilate. It was early in the morning, which wasn't that unusual in that day and age. The day started out early, the work day, and so at the end of verse 28, this is where we get to something that I feel is quite ironic. Here you have the Jewish leaders who are very concerned about their religious purity. It was the time of the Passover celebration, and so it was forbidden for them to enter a Jewish home. If they did so, they would be considered defiled and they'd be barred from participating in the Passover celebrations like eating the Passover lamb. And yet, they're so careful not to defile themselves, and yet here in their hearts, they're defiled because they're trying to manipulate the system in order to kill Jesus, who's the Lamb of God. Their rituals were empty. And it was just a way to clear their conscience. And as I read that and I think about it, I think we have to ask ourselves, we have to examine our own religious activities, our actions, and ask, are there rituals that we have that are empty? Rituals in our faith? Are there rituals that I do in my faith that just ease my conscience before God? Since the Jewish leaders wouldn't go into Pilate's palace, verse 29, Pilate came out to them and asked, what charges are you bringing against this man? As a Roman governor, Pilate really had no interest in the matters that involved local religion. He could care less. Pilate was only concerned about the interests of the Roman Empire. Is this guy a threat? So he asked a reasonable question. What are the charges you're bringing against this guy? But if you look at the response from the Jewish leaders, you can tell they're a little upset. It's a bit of a rude and disrespectful response, and maybe we need to get tone here, but I'm thinking they're like, if he were not a criminal, we wouldn't have brought him to you. I mean, maybe the Jewish leaders were thinking, this is just Pilate belittling us. Maybe he's just, well, how could he even dare to ask this question? Do we think he's guilty? And I think their response is just kind of shows the hostility or the tension between the Jewish people and Pilate. And Pilate's response, I can't help but think that there's a subtle jab or an attempt to rub Roman superiority in the face of the Jewish leaders. This is what he says in verse 31. He says, take him yourself and judge him by your own law. But we have no right to execute anyone, they objected. He's like, all right, you can't execute anyone. Huh? Only I can do that. Well, yeah, right. I mean, he knew that. He knew that. I think he was just trying to do a little bit of a dig. And it's true. The Romans were the only ones. The Roman government was the only one who had the authority to execute anyone. The charge of blasphemy, though, which is claiming to be God, that was punishable by stoning someone to death. And that the Jews could enforce under an ancient law back in Leviticus chapter 24. And if we read this trial or this in the book of Matthew, we read the version there, chapter 26, verse 64. Jesus says this to the high priest. This is still the trial. He says, "From now on, you will see the Son of Man," in other words, Jesus, "sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look, you have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" "He is worthy of death," they answered. And after the Romans took control over the Jewish people, they removed their right to execute someone. So now capital punishment had to be approved by the Roman government. But in this case, that might be to the advantage of the Jewish leaders, because for one, Jesus was quite popular. He had quite a following, and if the Roman soldiers are the one to carry out the execution, well, who's going to try and stop them, right? You'd be killed. Another reason it was a bit of an advantage was that if the Jewish people saw someone being crucified, that was a sign of God's curse on them, according to Deuteronomy 21:23. So the Jewish leaders hoped that Jesus' death by crucifixion, well, that would be a clear indication that he couldn't possibly be the Messiah. I mean, no one would believe the Messiah would be cursed. And I'll talk more about that later. So the Jewish leaders charged Jesus with blasphemy, which is claiming to be God, which he actually did claim. But blasphemy is a Jewish religious law, and it didn't really interest Pilate at all. He could care less. So then the Jewish leaders had to come up with another charge against him that would interest Pilate. Something that would prove to be a threat to Pilate or to the Roman Empire. So they did some scheming, and as we look at this story in the book of Luke, he records three charges that they brought against Jesus there. The first charge was that he was undermining the authority of the nation. The second charge is that he was opposing paying tax to Caesar. And both of those weren't true. But the third one, that gets Pilate's attention. Luke 23:2, they said, "Jesus claims to be the Messiah, the King." If we look back in Matthew 16:16, Peter says to Jesus, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus said to him, that was revealed to you by my Father." In other words, that's true. In the New Testament, Jesus is sometimes called Jesus Christ. Now, Christ isn't his last name. Christ is a Greek word for Messiah, and it means anointed one. Anointed one. And that, if we look in the Old Testament, a man who was anointed was sometimes associated with being a king. So if we think of that, remember when the Magi came to see Jesus when he was born, they said, "Where is he who has been born what? King. King of the Jews." They were looking for a king. So getting back to the third charge against Jesus, yeah, Messiah, yep, king, yes. And that was a problem for Rome, because the title of king was only something that could be given by the emperor. And to do it otherwise was considered treason. And that was punishable by death, by execution, and specifically by crucifixion. Now, before we get to Pilate questioning Jesus, we can't overlook verse 32. Look at verse 32. It says, "This took place to fulfill what Jesus had said about the kind of death he was going to die." The Jewish leaders and Pilate had no idea they were going to be part of fulfilling prophecy. A few chapters earlier in John chapter 12, verse 32, Jesus predicts his own death when he says this, "And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." If the Jews were to execute Jesus, it would be by stoning. But Jesus had just predicted, I just read it, he predicted that he would be lifted up, which refers to the cross used in a crucifixion, which was distinctly a form of execution by the Romans. So Pilate and the Jewish leaders, thought they were in control of the situation, and yet Jesus ensures that he will be crucified in order to fulfill what he said about his death. So I find that quite amazing. The others think they're in control, but actually Jesus is behind the scenes working to fulfill prophecy about himself. Had Jesus been stoned, as the Jews would maybe have liked to, his bones would likely have been broken. Psalm 34:20 is a prophecy that none of Christ's bones will be broken. And if we were to keep reading into John 19, we see the crucifixion, none of his bones were broken. Verse 33, Jesus and Pilate get face to face. Listen to what happens. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Now, why would he ask that? We assume John didn't record that the Jewish leaders told Pilate about the charges. And I think it causes Pilate to ask a political question. Are you the king of the Jews? I can't help but think that Pilate was kind of probing to see if Jesus was a political threat to himself or to Rome. Because it had happened before. We'll find that at the end of this story, Barabbas, he wasn't claiming to be a king, but he certainly was against Rome. So in order to determine the threat level against Rome, Pilate asks a legitimate question. Yeah, well, are you the king of the Jews? I mean, and Jesus is not intimidated. He responds to Pilate's question with another question of his own. So we have the prisoner questioning the judge, and this is what he asks. Is that your own idea? Jesus asks, or did others talk to you about me? In other words, are you asking this because you think I'm a political threat, or are you just repeating what you've heard from other people? I believe that Jesus is concerned for Pilate's soul, and he's fishing around a bit. He's saying, are you asking for yourself, or maybe you're taking an interest? Do you want to ask some questions about the Messiah? And Jesus never denies that he's a king, but we'll soon find out. Pilate and Jesus have very different interpretations of the word king. Pilate doesn't have a need to worry that Jesus is going to be some kind of political threat to Rome. No. He kind of sneers at Jesus' question, and he asks another question of his own. Let's look at the next verse, verse 35. Am I a Jew? Pilate replied, your own people and chief priests handed you over to me. What is it you've done? And I think here we get to, I think, what is the climax of this passage. Verse 36, Jesus explains a little bit about his kingdom, but Pilate's secular thinking just does not catch on. Verse 36, Jesus says, my kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now my kingdom is from another place. He gives a brief description of his kingdom, and he makes it clear that Jesus' kingdom has nothing to do with gathering a bunch of soldiers and conquering another country. That's not the type of kingdom that Pilate understands. He's not catching on. Jesus says his kingdom doesn't come through guerrilla warfare. It's a kingdom from another place, from heaven, created by God. It's a kingdom that comes through submission to God. It's a spiritual kingdom that doesn't fight for land. It desires souls through spiritual rebirth and transformation. Soon we see that Jesus' kingdom is based on his surrendering himself to pay the price, the punishment for the sins of the world. But Pilate's heart is closed. He doesn't get it. He just doesn't understand. He doesn't inquire about Jesus' kingdom. He doesn't show any interest because he doesn't realize who he's talking to. Look at verse 37. You are a king then, Pilate said. Jesus answered, you say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me. Now look at this. Look at what he says. He says, the reason I was born, that speaks to his humanity. He was born like every human. The reason I came into the world, that speaks to his divinity. Jesus is human, born on earth, yes, but he's also the Son of God from another world, from heaven. I asked the question, do you know why Jesus came to the earth? I think that's an important question to ask. And Jesus tells us to testify to the truth. What does that mean? Does that mean that Jesus came down to heaven just to encourage us to tell the truth? A lie detector test? He is truth. His words are true. In fact, earlier in chapter 14, verse 6, he tells his disciples, I am the truth. Truth is what we see when we see God. Jesus is the Son of God. He is truth in the flesh. And here again, I think we see Jesus' compassion. We see his concern for this cynical Pilate. The last sentence, verse 37, we have the prisoner offering freedom to the judge. Now, how ironic is that? The prisoner offering freedom to the judge. Jesus knows that soon he'll experience an excruciating death, a horrible death, and yet he extends an invitation to Pilate. This is what he says. He says, the end of verse 37, everyone on the side of truth listens to me. Jesus is like a fisherman with some bait, and he's holding it out there, trying to get Pilate to bite. He's trying to draw Pilate to himself. He's saying, come on, Pilate, pursue a little. Ask some questions. Aren't you at least curious? You can know truth. Listen to what I have to say. Pilate is challenging, or Jesus is challenging Pilate to align himself with truth. And now Pilate is obligated to respond. I think Jesus here is an example for us. When the opportunity arises, when it presents itself, speak the truth about who Jesus is to you. The listener has a burden then to respond, but our job as followers of Jesus is to speak truth about Jesus. So in our story, the living truth, Jesus himself, he gives Pilate an invitation. He offers a challenge. And what's Pilate's response? Do you see it there? What is truth? And he walks away. He doesn't even wait for Jesus to answer. Really, it's a statement. It's not a question. He just walks away, and Jesus lets him go. That I find surprising. Why wouldn't Jesus call back to him and say, hey, Pilate, come on, let's talk about it. Try and reason with him, or maybe try and convince him. But no, Jesus does not force anyone to follow him. That's not love. Jesus doesn't force anyone to care, and Pilate doesn't care. Truth is totally irrelevant for this Roman politician. Now, why isn't Pilate interested in truth? I wonder about that. And maybe one reason is because he thought truth would interfere with his life. And I think that's a key reason that people still today ignore truth. They see it as interfering with their life. It affects their relationships. Truth will affect who a young adult dates and marries. Truth will affect how you spend your leisure time, how you spend your money. Truth will affect how you operate your business. Pilate knew that following truth would affect his job as a governor. And he'll do whatever it takes to keep his job. It's a delicate balance because he has to show the people who's boss. Oh, but he has to be a little bit careful because if they complain, if the Jewish leaders get upset, they might stir the people and there'd be a riot. Or they might go complain to Rome, which is exactly what happened a few years later. Secular history tells us that Pilate, well, he made one too many infractions in AD 36, 10 years after he started governing. He was basically fired, and he was sent back to Rome in shame. Now, our story takes place a few years before that. Pilate knows his position is on shaky ground. If it comes to a decision between upholding truth or upholding the peace, well, He knew the life of a politician meant that sometimes there has to be compromises. Meaning, Pilate wasn't willing to act on truth if it threatened his job security. And I think the second reason that Pilate maybe wasn't interested in truth is because maybe he wasn't convinced there was an answer to his question, what is truth? And I think that's where many in our secular society are today. Absolute truth, kind of a sliding scale in many people's minds. Truth depends on how I feel. What's true for you may not be true for me. I like the way one pastor put it. He said, you can have a belief about truth, but you can't decide what is truth. You can't choose it. Pilate didn't recognize the truth, even when truth was staring him in the face. But he did recognize a truth, the truth that Jesus was innocent. Verse 38, he says, I find no basis for a charge against him. And that should have ended it. That should have been the end of the court session. Here we have Pilate, who's supposed to be this judge standing up for truth. He should have said, I have no basis for a charge against him. He's innocent. He's released. End of the story. That's the case dismissed. And yet Pilate was faced with an inconvenient truth. If you let Jesus go, the Jewish leaders would freak out, and they would just rile up the crowd, and there'd be a frenzy. It would make Pilate look bad. So he makes a compromise, which backfires. Verse 39. This is Pilate speaking. But it is your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of the Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews? Well, Pilate was willing to follow precedent of the time during in the celebration during Passover. He would give the Jewish people the choice to free one prisoner. And Pilate offers to release Jesus to them, and he even calls him the king of the Jews. And I wonder why he called Jesus that, because he knew that would get the Jewish leaders upset, because that was the charge against him. But I wonder if Pilate was thinking, he knew that Jesus was very popular, and perhaps he was trying to play the general crowd. Maybe he thought they would prefer Barabbas, because Jesus was so popular. And that's why I believe that Pilate was shocked and troubled in verse 40 when the people actually do choose Barabbas. And that forces Pilate to, for one, to release Barabbas, who was in jail because he had taken part in an uprising, so an obvious political threat to Rome. And two, he had to decide what to do with the man accused of being a political threat to Rome. And Pilate knew the truth. Jesus was innocent. Following that truth would be very inconvenient. So he compromised his integrity, and he did what was in his best interest. To his credit, he did try a few other options to try and get Jesus released, but really when push came to shove, he caved. Chapter 19, 16, finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified. And the Roman soldiers came. They took Jesus to a hill just outside Jerusalem, and there they lifted him up and put him on a cross, just like Jesus predicted. The Apostle Peter writes this about Jesus. He says, he committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. What is truth? Jesus is perfect. He's the Son of God. He was tried, he was convicted, he was executed like a common criminal. And do you know what the most shocking part is? He went through it willingly. When we break God's moral standard or his law, it puts us under the curse of sin. We desperately need someone to lift this curse of sin from us. So what is truth? Apostle Paul wrote Galatians 3:13, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree. To be crucified on a tree, or in other words, a cross, was to be cursed by God. Someone said that Christ had to be cursed for us through the crucifixion in order that the curse be lifted from us. How did Jesus take this curse of sin from us? 1 Peter 2:24, we're told, He himself bore our sin in his body on the cross so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds, we have been healed. So what is truth according to this verse? Jesus became our substitute on the cross when he died in our place, and thereby he took the punishment of our sin. In response, we are to devote ourselves to living in a holy manner, as someone has put it. And so that's my challenge to you, to follow truth, to follow Jesus, the one who paid for your sins when he died on the cross. He extends the invitation to you. And if you want to know more, you can talk to myself, one of the pastors, one of the leaders from your church. And let's worship together. Let's be grateful for the sacrifice that he made on our behalf. And let's express our desire to follow truth, to follow Christ by singing the closing song. I'll ask the music team to come up and you can get your bulletins out and turn to the back page. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Upon Jesus, look for his wonderful ways, and the things of the earth feel strange indeed in the light of his glory and grace. Jesus, to you lift our us our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Turn your eyes to the hillside where justice and Son of God gave his life for us, in the measureless death was he raised. Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our prize. We adore
for coming, and what a joy it is to celebrate as community churches together. We don't want this celebration to end, so the Hague Community Church will be meeting at 10:30 this Sunday. Hague Gospel Church will be meeting at 10:30 as well. And here in New Onlog, I think the service starts at 11. So if you aren't a part of any of those churches, feel free to join us in worship. I chose this morning's benediction out of Ephesians 3. Now to him who is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. And all of God's people say, amen. You can go in peace.